All peoples, clap your hands, cry to God with shouts of joy. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
My dear brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mystery. Lord Jesus, you have shown us the way to the Father. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you have given us the consolation of the truth. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are the good shepherd, leading us into everlasting life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. A reading from the book of the prophet Amos. Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent word to Jeroboam, king of Israel. Amos has conspired against you here within Israel. The country cannot endure all his words. For this is what Amos says: Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel shall surely be exiled from its land. To Amos, Amaziah said, off with you, visionary, flee to the land of Judah. There earn your bread by prophesying, but never again prophesy in Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary in a royal temple. Amos answered Amaziah, I was no prophet, nor have I belonged to a company of prophets. I was a shepherd, and a tresser of sycamores. The Lord took me from following the flock and said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel. Now hear the word of the Lord. You say, prophesy not against Israel, preach not against the house of Isaac. Now thus says the Lord, your wife shall be made a harlot in the city, and your sons and daughters shall fall by the sword. Your land shall be divided by measuring line, and you yourself shall die in an unclean land. Israel shall be exiled far from its land. The word of the Lord. The judgments of the Lord are true, and all of them are just. The judgments of the Lord are true, and all of them are just. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The decree of the Lord is trustworthy, giving wisdom to the simple. The judgments of the Lord are true, and all of them are just. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The command of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eye. The judgments of the Lord are true, and all of them are just. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true, all of them are just. The judgments of the Lord are true, and all of them are just. They are more precious than gold, than a heap of purest gold, sweeter also than syrup, or honey from the comb. The judgments of the Lord are true, and all of them are just. and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Hallelujah. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. After entering a boat, Jesus made the crossing and came into his own town. And there, people brought to him a paralytic lying on a stretcher. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, "Courage, child, your sins are forgiven." At that, some of the scribes said to themselves, "This man is blaspheming." Jesus knew what they were thinking and said, "Why do you harbor evil thoughts? Which is easier to say, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Rise and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he then said to the paralytic, "Rise, pick up your stretcher, and go home." He rose and went home. When the crowd saw this, they were struck with awe and glorified God who had been given such authority to men. The Gospel of the Lord. So in both of our readings, we have the image of God saying, "Don't underestimate me. Don't underestimate what I can do." In the first reading, you have the prophet Amos. You know, it's worth knowing that prophets, there were people in that time period who would say that they were prophets. They would come into a town, say, "I'm a prophet, I'm here to tell you what God has to say to you." And people would pay them money, people would give them food to live that way. And so, you know, like, "I really need to know what the Lord thinks about whether or not I should plant my seeds in the garden today, or should I wait until next week?" You know, spring season, when do we plant, when do we harvest? So they go talk to the prophet, divine from the Lord, what I should do. You know, they go to their gods, they go to whatever, and then the person talks to the prophet and gets the answer from them. So you have professional prophets. Professional prophets. And people would go to them and pay money, pay food to get answers. What does God think? What do the gods think? So Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, tells the king, "You got this guy over here named Amos, who's causing quite a bit of problems because he's saying that the kingdom's going to fall and that you're doing bad things. We need to get rid of this guy." And then the priest turns around and tells the prophet Amos, "Get out of here. Wait, you just go find your work somewhere else. We don't want to hear what you've got to say. We don't like what your answers are." And the prophet Amos is saying, "Look here now. I don't want this job. I don't want to be a prophet. I'm doing this because God asked me to do it." Never underestimate that God might actually choose people to be prophets. That there would be people in the world who can speak on behalf of God. And I know this for myself, because as a priest, I've watched bishops, you know, and other priests, and watch myself. Someone will come up and say, "Hey, Father, I got a great idea. We should do this, we should do this, we should do this, we should do this, we should do this," or whatever I can come up with. And I'm sitting there going, "Oh, who's going to run in? How are we going to pay for it?" My mind goes through all the practicals. What I need to do is legitimately stop and pray and ask the Lord, "Did you send this person into our midst to call us to do this? As hard as it might be to pull it off, is this what you want, Lord?" Because the Lord is capable of sending people into our midst that give us ideas of how to handle things. And this is not just, you know, for me as a pastor, for all of us. Maybe our kids come to us and say, you know, Mom and Dad, you should really consider doing this. It doesn't seem practical, it doesn't seem like the time is right, I'm not sure if I like the idea. It means giving something up, or it means doing something that I don't want to do. I just don't want to do it. Just leave me alone. Don't talk to me. And maybe the Lord actually wants to accomplish this. And we have to be able to be willing to stop with our life and ask that deeper question. Lord, did you send my child? Did you send my next door neighbor? Did you send my friend into my midst to say this hard thing to me in order to call me to some greater thing in life? In the gospel, we see the paralytic. Here you have someone who, whether they fell or grew up that way, they can't move their arms and their legs. Paraplegic. Okay? Or full body, whatever that is. The full paraplegic, okay? Now, paraplegic, I don't know which one's which. Two arms, both legs, I don't know. Anyway, see, that's someone who's not able to move their body, alright? And the house where Jesus is at is really about the size of, well, this pulpit times three. Put nine of these together, this pulpit, and that's as big as the house is. And Jesus is inside. This is Capernaum, and this is where Jesus has otherwise been living for about 2 years or so. And they want to get in to see Jesus, and they can't get in to see him. And so they literally tear the roof off of the house, and they lower this guy in on a stretcher in to be close to Jesus, because they've heard that he has healing powers. And the response that Jesus has to it is he sees their faith to look beyond what they see of someone who's paralyzed and cannot walk. Courage, child, your sins are forgiven. And there's a little complex reality about what sins mean and being ill and all that. And the scribes are saying, so this guy is blasphemy. Nobody can forgive sins. Who's allowed to do that but God alone? And Jesus responds, which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven, or rise and walk? Now, the high priest at the temple had the freedom once a year to tell all the people that their sins were forgiven. So the human priest was able to do this on the Feast of Yom Kippur every year, to take the sins of the people and heap them on the scapegoat and send them out, the scapegoat, out in the desert to die, and then take the lamb and sacrifice it on the altar for the sins of the people once a year. So for a priest to say their sins are forgiven is not impossible. And to tell somebody who's a paralyzed person, get up and walk, which of the two of these is harder to do? The paralyzed one. And for Jesus then to say, rise, pick up your mat, and walk, it validates that Jesus has this power. Now, the reason for us is we must never underestimate that God has the capacity to come through the miracle. We might say to ourselves, oh, I know so-and-so. They're always going to be that way. They're always going to be a jerk. They're always going to be mean. They're always going to be hot-tempered. And what we ought to do is pray that the person would have a conversion of heart, and then not be surprised that they actually do, that that person actually turns around their behavior pattern and is nice to us in a moment that we never expected them. Or that someone might be physically healed. And then if they are, to praise the Lord and, in a way, not be surprised that God actually has the power to do that. So we underestimate God. We don't give God freedom to move and act and to have people be changed in their lifestyles. Because very often we don't see those changes and we don't see the miracles happening. And so don't have faith. And we are the ones that have little faith, as Jesus has referred to. So it's good for us to have faith. Jesus can do these things. God does call prophets. The Lord does speak to us and call us to himself, and does ask us to have faith every day. We pray for our Holy Father, Pope Francis, pray for our bishops, that they can guide and teach us to stay close to Christ and always hear the prophetic voice of God, wherever it may be. We pray to the Lord. We pray for all those who are sick, those who are suffering in any way. Pray for those who take care of them, those who do home visits, those who work with social services. We pray to the Lord. We pray for all of those who have any mental health struggles of any kind, those who are struggling with depression and anxiety. We pray to the Lord. We pray for all those who are struggling to trust God, those whose faith is weak, those who are asking for a miracle. We pray to the Lord. We pray for those who have died and gone before us in faith. We pray for Louise Tyson, for whom this Mass is offered, for the next person from our community, whom the Lord will call to himself. We pray to the Lord. Heavenly Father, we ask that you hear all of these prayers. We ask them through Christ our Lord. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine, a work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray, that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him you have been pleased to renew all things, giving us all a share in his fullness. For though he was in the form of God, he emptied himself and by the blood of his cross brought peace to all creation. Therefore he has been exalted above all things, and to all who obey him has become the source of eternal salvation. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Donald, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Lamb of God,
Amen.
You take away your sins. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all within me his holy name. An act of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there, and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen. Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and received fill us with life, O Lord, we pray, so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.